Well, I'm Rick Chappell, and it's great to have all of you here. For those of you who were here last week, Joey Barnett is a hard act to follow. He's a splendid person, and he's a person of whom there are thousands in America that do just amazing things every day that we unfortunately don't know very much about. We don't have time to tell their stories. Somehow, after we finish telling all the stories, we fill up the airways with. And somebody came up afterwards, after Joey's talk last week, and said, you know, the kids need to be around people like Joey. I mean, they need to know what possibilities there are in exploration. And I couldn't agree with that more. I think America, which needs the things that come out of exploration now more than we ever have in terms of our ability to compete internationally, our kids need to be around people like that, or they need to know about people like that, because many of the of our bright young grandchildren are going to, if they knew about opportunities like that, might choose a career there. So, I mean, we have a story to tell about exploration in America that we're not telling very well, and it in time it makes it a little more difficult for us as a nation. In the talk that I do at the end of this series, I'm going to come back and just talk specifically about that topic, sort of the things that America, the opportunities we have in exploration, the things we need to think about doing in the future. We got a little out of sync because the talk I'm going to give today would have been an initial one, but Joey, the only time we could get Joey was last week, so and I wanted you to hear from him. And so I'm going to talk today about the general process that people go through who are explorers. How do they do their work? What are the steps that they go through? And I'm going to do that by comparing what Columbus did in that regard with what I did in that regard. Now, I'm reminded of a book that I read as a child that you may have read. It was called Ben and Me. It was about a mouse. It was written by a mouse who lived in Ben Franklin's house. And the mouse observed all of the things that Ben Franklin did, with particularly the key up the kite cord and the electricity and all that sort of stuff, and told that story. The reason it reminded me, I mean, Columbus and me, reminds me of Ben and me, is that Ben Franklin was a lot more significant than the mouse, and Columbus was a whole lot more significant than I am. But we went through I have been going through an exploration process which is similar to the one that Columbus did. So I'm going to just show you, I'm just going to switch back and forth between Columbus's era and my era, about 500 years apart. And I want to start by showing you a video that we made when I was at NASA to reflect the differences in the vehicles of exploration over a 500-year period. And we were fortunate enough to arrange to have the Columbus ships, which the Spanish government built for the 500th anniversary of Columbus voyage, 1992. The Spanish government built these ships, and then they came to America, and they came all around the American coastline. And we were able, through good fortune, goodwill, God willing, all of those things, to get the ships to sail by the shuttle launch pad when the shuttle was on the launch pad one day before it launched. And if you know anything about how they have to shut down half of the Atlantic Ocean when the shuttle's going to launch, you can imagine it's not an easy thing to make that happen, and it just has to, I mean, there just has to be somebody big up there that wants it to happen. And so it happened, and we got all these images, and the images are played or have music to them that came from the movie Blue Planet, if you've ever seen Blue Planet, which is, if you haven't, it's a spectacular film about the Earth, images taken from space. So let's see if I can get this to play just for kind of a mood piece in the beginning. want to back up here. Let's see.
Let's stop it, pause it, and then we'll go right there.
So it, so it really wants to, I wonder if I can pop it out and then, let's, what should we pop out and try again? Let's see.
Okay, let's see. Hopefully it didn't smart enough to realize.
There's a restart on the eject.
There's a...
Take it just a minute.
So it's got to initialize the disk.
Let me remind
you
a little bit here.
Okay. Boy, it's persistent.
Oh, God.
Maybe, do you have to stop it, do you think?
It
should.
Do
you have to stop instead of pause? What if we stop? Stop and rewind. This, no, it's restart. There we go. So it's not a lightning strike, but it's digital technology that's got us right now. Okay, so here we go. Okay. So just picture yourself someplace in the edge of the Atlantic around the Kennedy Space Center. That's the money shot right there.
Yeah.
Thank you. So see if you can see an anchor. So you can imagine what's required, all the things that have to happen that you can't control in order to have all of those things be in the same place at the right time with the right weather, with four cameras and helicopters, and it's unbelievable. But it's one of those moments in time, you know, it was for everybody to look at. And so that was a very special time that brought the things related to Columbus, replicas of his ships, together with something that I was involved in exploration. My career in exploration has had two parts of it. One is just the science, the robotic missions to study the environment of the Earth, the space environment of the Earth, and the other was a human spaceflight where I trained as a passenger on the shuttle. I didn't get to fly, but I went through the training and went through the mission, which was in 1992. So it was on the 500th anniversary of Columbus' voyage. During that same period of the year that he was in the Caribbean 500 years before. And so I have a link to him both as an explorer and through this connection of looking at these dramatically different vehicles of exploration over how they change over a 5-century period. The music, if you haven't seen Blue Planet, you should try to do that. It's often shown in Huntsville at the Space and Rocket Center. It's probably shown out in the IMAX theater out at Opryland, or you can rent it. It is an absolutely gorgeous movie, and the music is spectacular. It's great music just to listen to. And exploration has a lot of spirit in it. I mean, you could tell in listening to Joey talk. I mean, if you do this, it has a lot of heart in it. You know, you're doing things that are very difficult, that take a long time, but that have just, I mean, you're sort of swept along with it. And music, of course, brings us that. So one thing we tried to do at NASA was to combine the music, in some instances familiar music, popular music, with images of exploration, just to show, or to give the feeling of exploration. So let me do a little Columbus and Me here now. Let me see if I can do this. So Columbus was born in 1451. He lived 55 years. He died about 14 years after his first voyage. So that was really in the end of his life. And he did four voyages, and he died shortly after the fourth voyage to America. I was born in 1943, and fortunately, I'm still around. I'm 66 at this point. And I've been doing exploration I've been involved in exploration for about 42 years at this stage. So it's pretty much of my life. I want to talk about both the kind of people who do exploration and then the process that they go through. So first of all, the kind of people. And I'll just talk about Columbus, what I know about Columbus and me. First of all, people who do exploration are, the dominant thing about them is that they're curious. So they're not happy to just have the world and the universe go on around them without understanding it. So there's this natural desire to try to understand how things work. For Columbus, after he had spent time in Portugal working around people who were making charts based on the Portuguese expeditions, mostly down to Africa. He became fascinated by the idea of getting to China and Japan by going west instead of going across land like Marco Polo had done it years before, a much harder way of doing things. So he began to work with the charts and look at estimates of size of the Earth and that sort of thing, and began to create a voyage in his mind. My thoughts were more about, so on the upper left is the Earth, that's taken from Apollo. It's a spectacular picture. The United States is right in the middle of that picture. So there's Baja California right there. There's the United States, there's Florida. Caribbean is right there. South America is right here. So Columbus was trying to figure out how to go west and get to China, Japan. If you're optimistic about how small the Earth is, then that way that approach would have worked. And there was a range of estimates then about how big the Earth was. Most people thought the Earth was round at that point, contrary to songs and poems and all that kind of thing. But the question was how big the Earth was, which makes a whole lot of difference in how long you can stay on a ship in the ocean before you get to the other side. Columbus was optimistic in his estimates of how small the Earth was in order to predict this voyage. My exploration is about trying to understand the space environment of the Earth. So here's the Sun, much closer, fortunately, than it really is, just for this drawing. Here's the solar wind that flows out of the Sun, and this is the Earth right here. And then this strange looking thing is called the magnetosphere. So that's the magnetic envelope of the Earth. And that magnetic envelope goes about 10,000 or 50,000 miles in the direction of the Sun, millions of miles away from the Sun. If you could see it, it has a long tail on it back here. And it gets filled up with gases that come either from the Sun or from the Earth. And that's the principal question. For all the plasma, and these are ionized atoms, for all the plasma that you find in the magnetosphere, how much comes from the Earth, how much comes from the Sun? Did we? Okay. John, have you got me back there? Seems like I'm cutting out a little bit.
Yeah, it's working
out. Let me put it up here and see if that helps. It's still working? Y'all okay in the back? Okay. So mine's a space environment type exploration, which you have to do with spacecraft. Columbus was a get all the way around the world, which at that time you could try to do with ships. The second thing about people who are in this business, they're extremely determined because it's not easy stuff. It's difficult to understand, but it's difficult to carry out all of the work that's required to find out an answer. In Columbus' case, he had to have some money from somebody to do it. In Joey Barnett's case, he needed money from the National Institutes of Health. In my case, I needed money from the National Aeronautics and Space Administration or the National Science Foundation. And you have to sell that, and you have to hang in there, because many times it's many, many, many years before the support ever comes. Columbus' situation was dangerous. People didn't know what was out there. There were a lot of ideas about what was out in the faraway ocean, but not a lot of information. In my case, it's less dangerous than it is difficult. It just requires a lot of training and education to understand enough to get yourself to the edge of the sphere of knowledge that we all have, to try to add something onto it that nobody's ever known before. When you add on to the knowledge that humankind has, it takes a lot of preparation academically to get there. People who do exploration are extremely optimistic. Columbus took an optimistic view of the size of the Earth. He really wanted to do this. He was determined. Scientists are optimistic. If you listen to what Joey talked about, it's unbelievable what you have to do to change the gene in a chicken embryo to see what it's going to do in terms of making a heart valve, which you can't even, you can barely see under a microscope. It's very, very difficult, and you have to believe, really, that you can ultimately succeed as an explorer. So people who do this are optimists, optimists almost to a fault. I mean, they will go and do things and try to do things that nobody would ever try to do They have a vision of where they're headed, a very strong vision of where they're headed, and they can portray that vision effectively so that people want to help them. They want to give them money. They want to be part of what they do. There's a quote from Goethe, which you've probably heard, that says, "Whatever you do or dream you can, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it. Begin it now." So what he was saying was that if you really believe in something and have a vision of what you might do and dream of what you might become, you need to get started with that. Don't just sit around and think about it. Get started with it, because when you get started with it, people come and offer to help. If you're good at articulating your vision of what might be, people will come and ask if they can help you. This really happens. And if you don't get started, they don't know you're doing it, they won't come offer to help. So Columbus had to sell that vision to the queen and the king in order to get the money. People in my business have to sell that vision to NASA to get the funding. But once it gets going, I've had people walk into my office and say, "I'm really interested in what you're doing. Can I work for you?" And that's because, it's not because of me, it's just because the vision of what might be is exciting for them. And so they come and join you. And that's an important element of this. For both Columbus and me, it's humble beginnings. Let me see here. This is another Ben and me picture. On the left, Columbus was important enough to have his youth captured in marble and placed in a museum someplace. I don't have that and never will. But here's a photograph, which fortunately we had in 1953, of a person who wanted to be a successful baseball player and who was not. And that's a story I'll tell you later. But anyway, I grew up on a college campus in Montgomery, Alabama. My mother and father were both college teachers. My father taught history and my mother taught English. Academics were valued in my home, but we had a very modest existence. And for me, the call to exploration came because of lack of success in this. And our president on March 25th, 1961, saying that America was going to go to the moon. So that told me, that matched with what I was good at and told me what I should do with my life. Columbus grew up in Genoa on the edge of the ocean. His father was a tradesman, very modest existence. He was fascinated by the sea because he lived on the sea, and he went to sea when he was 25 years old. And then he was shipwrecked, and he ended up in Portugal, and that was his youth, fascinated by the sea principally. Okay, now I want to show you the process. Now I'm going to come back and forth to this. These are the steps of things that explorers do in order to explore, and I'm going to show you some pictures and kind of bounce back and forth with this. But every explorer goes through this process one way or another. Joey goes through this process in his exploration. I do it in mine. Columbus did it in his. People who are in the business, it's what they do. So I mentioned the curiosity that gives you a motivation. Now, if you're a physical scientist, the curiosity, the motivation comes from just a desire to understand things the way they are. Columbus had that same curiosity, but he had an additional motivation, which was an economic motivation, which was if they could establish trade routes by going west, and that was quicker than going the other way, then that was going to be a benefit to his country and benefit to him ultimately if he was successful. So he had both a power and a financial interest in addition to just being curious. Okay. The second thing then is figure out what you're going to do. Now, in Columbus' case, his plan was to get some ships and sail, put enough men on them to keep them running, get enough food and wine and water to get there and head out. And it was a big thing for him to accomplish that, but that was his plan. For me, it was to figure out how to build an instrument that nobody had ever built before that could be flown on a satellite that would go up into space around the Earth and measure the composition of the gases there. How much oxygen is there? How much hydrogen? How much helium? How much nitrogen? Because the gases that are there will give you some information on where they came from. If it's oxygen and it's in the Earth's environment, it had to come from the Earth. If it's hydrogen, it could have come from the Earth, but it also could have come from the sun. If it's helium doubly charged, it only comes from the sun. So by measuring the composition of the gases there, you get an idea of where they came from. So that was my plan. Both of us put together proposals. He put together with charts and things like that a proposal that he had to take to the sovereign to try to get the money. My proposal was more of a 50-page typed with blue covers on it saying, here's what I'd really like to do and here's some sketches of how I think we could do this. And it was mailed into NASA. So here comes the funding part. There's some neat pictures of, here's Columbus. This is this grand picture. I think this is in Cordoba in this incredible mosque. It was originally a mosque that's now a Christian church. And here's Columbus. Here's Isabel. She looks like she has a headache or something. I'm not sure. And Ferdinand. And then we have the church represented. And Columbus is talking about this idea. There's a statue of the three of them in the garden outside of this church in Cordoba. Some of you may have been there. It's a beautiful spot. So they did what often they listened. He had been recommended by a friend of his in a monastery where he was staying in, or convent where he was staying in Palos down on the coast. And the friar there was friends with Isabella and got him this hearing. So he told his story, and like most governments do, they referred it to a committee. So here's the committee. So this is in Salamanca, Spain, and they asked Columbus to go and present this idea to the learned people that they were comfortable with. And he did that. Here he is. He's got his charts, and here are the different learned people listening. So they took his request under advisement and thought about it. I think it was a couple of years. It was at least a year. They thought about it a long time. And they were trying to decide, is this a good thing to do based on what they knew about the world, which wasn't much. And so they ended up turning him down ultimately. And they gave four reasons, and I could read them to you, but they're almost gobbledygook. They don't make any sense at all to us in terms of what we understand now. But then they were pretty learned reasons. So, by the way, this was the third time that Columbus had asked for money. When he was in Portugal, he asked King John of Portugal once for the money. He got turned down. He asked a second time. He got turned down. He went to Spain. He lived in Palos a while. He made the connection, Ferdinand and Isabella. This is the third time he asked, and he got turned down. They turned him down. And so he went back. He thought about it. He did some more politics, and he did some more shaping of the mission. He went back again to Ferdinand and Isabella. This turns out this is in Santa Fe, which is sort of a suburb of Granada. So they were fighting a war with the Moors, and it had all come down to a siege in Granada, which the principal stronghold of the Moorish Empire in Spain at that time. And they were still fighting when he went to talk with them. He made the presentation again. They turned him down again. Then two things happened. Isabella's treasurer, Luis de San Angel, who was in charge of all the bucks, she didn't do the jewels thing, like the story goes. They had money. they had some money in the police fund, which was available. And after Columbus had left, St. Angel said to the Queen, you know, if we want to do this, I think we can find the money that he needs, and the people in Pallas owe us some money because they transgressed against us earlier. So we can put all that together and do this thing if you want to. And she said, well, I'll think about that. And then their army, the Christian army, the Catholic army, defeated the Moors in Granada, not long after Columbus was there on the outskirts. And he'd started back home on his donkey, and so they sent somebody after him. She changed her mind. They said, look, we've won the war. Let's, you know, let's try this. And so she sent somebody to get him, and they agreed to. If he was successful, to be named Admiral of the Ocean Sea, which was about as grand a title as you can imagine, to be governor of the territories that he found, and to get, I think it was 10% of whatever came out of it. So they made a deal. So that's the funding part, and for me, it was to write a proposal to NASA. But the satellite that we were to fly on didn't exist, and so part of this process has to do with bringing scientists together to talk about areas that should be important in space exploration, and then have NASA decide to do a new satellite. Fortunately, we both got the money, and the next step then is to design the apparatus, or in Columbus' case, to get something, a set of ships that would take him where he wanted to go to do his exploration. For me, it was to design an instrument that didn't exist, but which we had an idea about how it might work. So I've got a couple of pictures there. So there's Columbus part. And I'm going to show this Santa Maria, the Pinta, and the Nina. The way you can tell these two apart is that, the way I remember it, is that the Pinta has a little foredeck up here, and the Nina doesn't. So I remember Nina means none, and there's no foredeck on the Nina. Although those two ships, they're caravels, and they're pretty close to the same size. And they're great ships of exploration. They don't draw much water. They're very shallow runners. They can go a lot of places. This was the Santa Maria. It's a tub. It was a cargo ship. It draws a lot of water, 12 feet. It's very slow and big and bulky, but it's very small. It's only 75 feet long. So if you've been on a sailboat, let's say, that's 30, 40 feet long, it was twice that big and had 50 people on board. These ships had 25 each, so he had about 100 people on his voyage. I'm going to show you a picture of the crow's nest later on, but it's behind the sail, but there it is right there. I'll come back. That's a foreshadowing here in the talk. Now, here are the satellites. We decided we needed two satellites, about how big they needed to be, about how many instruments they needed to carry. Lobbied NASA, worked with NASA. I was in NASA at the time in Huntsville, but the money comes through Washington and headquarters. So working with headquarters to try to put that mission together, and it was called Dynamics Explorer. It did come together. We wrote the proposals, and this sketch shows two of the heads of the instrument that ended up being mine. There's one here, there's one here, and there's another one down here. And I have up here that I'll show you, I have this gold-plated piece, or one exactly like this one. This one is still in space, but I have the gold-plated piece, which I can show you, and the little cover that goes on the instrument, and I'm going to show you some more pictures of that. So here's a sequence of sort of to help you think through how do you start from scratch and build an instrument and fly it on a satellite. So this is a schematic of the idea we had. It's about the size of a shoebox. It has an opening in the side. The gases that are moving around the Earth in its magnetic field have enough energy. They'll go through, if you have an open hole there, they'll go through the hole. And then we had some grids to give them a little bit of energy, electrical grids. And then they go between two poles of a magnet, and they come out the other side. And the heavier ions take a bigger path through there, and the smaller ions take a smaller one. So you can have different, these are detectors that count the number of ions that are coming through. So the oxygen goes through, makes a bigger swing because it has more momentum to it, and goes into this one, and the hydrogen takes a smaller swing and goes into this one. So it's a way of separating the different ion compositions and tell how much of each is there. That was a schematic. Here's the instrument. This is part of the instrument. So that's looking into the aperture. This has very, very fine gold-plated grids across the front. The particles go through the grid. They go through that little bitty slit, which you may be able to see. They go straight on through, go through the magnet, and then here are the two detectors that count them in the back. Before, so here I am in 1980. The hairstyles were different then. And when I go to the barbershop, this strange thing happens where the hair that gets cut off my head when it lands on the thing, it's all mostly white. And I can't understand why that's happening, because I still think I look like this. Anyway, so here we've taken the instrument, and you have to calibrate the instrument before you fly it. You have to know if the instrument says it got one count, you have to know how many particles came in the front to give you that. You have to calibrate the instrument. We mostly buy electronics things now, and they're already ready to go. We don't have to do any calibration. But getting a new instrument set up so you understand what it's telling you is an important part. So the instrument is right here. It goes inside a vacuum chamber. You have to simulate the environment it's going to be in once it gets to space to make sure it works. So it's in a vacuum chamber, and it's on a little device, a table that will swing it back and forth, so you can shoot ions into the front of it, ions being electrically charged atoms. You shoot those into the front, and it tells you, and the ion source is right here, and it tells you how the instrument's working. And you have to control the instrument with a computer. That was the computer of the day. And you have to mechanically move the instrument inside. Stan Fields is the person who walked into my office and said, I'm really interested in what you're doing. Can I work for you? That was, I guess, 3 or 4 years after I went to NASA. And he worked for me for the rest of his career. He's a wonderful guy. Willie Wright from the University of Texas at Dallas. Hilton Hammock from the University of Texas. Okay, once you've got the instrument ready, you ship it to the contractor that's going to put it on the satellite, that's building the satellite. In this case, it was RCA. And so we shipped the instrument to New Jersey, and here, there it is right there, like in the drawing. There's another one right there, and there's another one down here. So there were three different heads. We shipped those to New Jersey. They integrated them. They put them into the satellite. And then once the satellite was put together, they shipped the satellite to the place where it was going to be launched. This satellite is going around the poles of the Earth, so you can't launch that out of the Kennedy Space Center, because if you do, the rocket will go over either Florida or the rest of the United States on its way up, and that's not a good thing in case there's a problem with the rocket. So if you're going to go into orbit that goes around the poles, you have to launch out of Vandenberg Air Force Base in just outside of Santa Barbara, where the coast of California kind of juts out, and then you can shoot straight south out of there. They go screaming by LAX, but they're pretty high by the time they go by there, offshore, and go into polar orbit. So this is a magical moment in which the satellite is being put on top of the rocket. Here's the top of the rocket. These guys are in a room up on a big gantry that's about 80 feet up in the air around the top of the rocket. And I'll show you the rest of the rocket here in a minute. There ended up being two satellites in this mission, and they got launched on the same rocket. One of them gets thrown off first in low Earth orbit, and then the other one gets carried on up into higher Earth orbit. There's my instrument right there, and it has a little tube attached to it. They're blowing dry nitrogen gas into the instrument all the time, because you're sitting near the ocean, there's a lot of water vapor, and you don't want that to get inside your instrument, so you have to blow dry air into it, basically, to keep the electronics okay. Here's the other satellite, Dynamics Explorer B and Dynamics Explorer A. Here are the guys that put all these things together. There's the end of the rocket sticking up in this room behind them. It takes lots and lots of people to do these things, and they're very talented people. Now, this is a magical picture. This is in that room. It's like, I went into this room. It's like, it's sort of like going into the room with the Ark of the Covenant or something. I mean, here you are. To get there, you have to change clothes. You have to put on a bunny suit. You have to do all the things so that you don't carry any dirt in there. Put booties on, do all that. And then you go up an elevator, and you have to go through all this security because they don't want to just let anybody in there. And then you walk into this room, and you're up on top of the rocket. Here's the rocket. It's below this. There's the top part of the rocket. And here are the satellites sitting there. So you can see guys working at different levels. This is called the fairing. It's the part that goes around the satellites so that when you're launched and you push these things up through the atmosphere, the wind is not just blowing on the satellite. So you have that fairing on there, and then once you get up above the atmosphere, it the bolts explode and it comes off. So here's part of the fairing, and then here's the other half right here, and they're getting ready to put the other half of the fairing on. When they do that, here's the rocket now. So this room it's been moved away now, but the room was up here on top of this. I'll show you a better picture of the rocket in a minute. And these are the scientists, and I'm right here. Still the same haircut. And these are people from all over the United States who have different instruments, who've built their instruments together, scientists and engineers in their universities mostly, and delivered them here, and they're all now coming together on the satellite. And then this is a Delta rocket. So it has liquid propulsion in the middle and engines down below, and then it has solid rockets that are strapped on the side to just give it the initial boost. And here's that fairing that I showed you a while ago. So all those guys were in a room which was hanging out around this part of the rocket. Okay, so we're ready to go.
Now this is at Vanderbilt.
That was at Vandenberg. That's at Vandenberg, yeah. So Vandenberg, and the military launches lots of spy satellites out of Vandenberg because they're in polar orbit. They want to be able to, see the whole Earth going around. So, but NASA launches out there, and we were going to launch shuttles out there, and built a whole lot of the launch pad so that shuttles could fly in polar orbit. But that, from a money point of view, that didn't end up happening. So we've designed and built the apparatus. Columbus, the ships; mine, the instrument; and the satellite. The next thing is to carry out the experiment. So here's Columbus. It would have been great if we'd had an artist that was following us around that could have done some of these unbelievable pictures, although this was, of course, done after the fact and is somewhat heroic in presentation. But anyway, here's Columbus on his ship getting ready to leave Palos. Now, Palos is in southwestern Spain, just down the river, just down the Tinto River from Seville, if you know that part of Spain. So there's Columbus leaving on his voyage, and here's Dynamics Explorer leaving on its voyage. This was a night launch from Vandenberg. All the liquid engines are running at this point, and the solids are getting ready to turn on, at which point the rocket will be released down below, and all these umbilical cords, which are putting air, dry air, and stuff like that in around the pad, they'll all fall off of there, and then it goes. And that all went well. It was launched. Okay, the next phase of things is to carry out the experiment, gather the data. Okay, here's Columbus. These are all of his voyages, and I'll come back to several of them in a minute, but here's the first voyage. He came across, straight across the Atlantic in the middle of hurricane season, didn't get a hurricane, came into San Salvador. This is the tip of Florida up here, so came into San Salvador, then down to Cuba, and then he had to sail into the wind, which was almost impossible in those ships, so he had to tack back and forth and back and forth all the way over here to what is now Haiti in the Dominican Republic. He called it La Isla Española, and it was shortened to Hispaniola. Isabella was the first settlement that he built there. The Santa Maria hit a reef and sank. He left 40 of his people there to sort of take care of the settlement. So he came over in October. He left in August. By the time he got over there, he stopped a couple of places. By the time he got over there, it was early October this week, the 12th of October when he got here. And he left here in right after Christmas time and came back early January, and it took him until March to get back to Spain. So the red track is his first voyage. I'll come back and show you these other voyages in a second. He gathered information. There he is landing. This is the heroic picture or painting of him landing in Hispaniola and claiming that for the crown. After his voyage, his first voyage, he took back lots of things that he found. So his data, the data that he gathered, had to do with artifacts. He found gold, not a lot of it, but some. He took some of the Indians, the natives, back with him. He took back hammocks. He took back things that they had that the Spanish had never seen. And this is in Barcelona, the king and queen. Here's Columbus. Here are the Indians standing over here. And he's got, it's sort of like a show and tell. Sort of, here's what I found. And he was already thinking about going back again and what he wanted to do next. For our instrument, and this is just one of the figures that sort of shows things, the satellite went around the Earth, around the poles, and the instrument that we had, Dynamics Explorer 1, measured particles that were streaming up out of the Earth's polar regions, called the polar wind. And this, if this shows that as the satellite spins, every once in a while you get a spike of, if it looks down toward the Earth, you get a spike of information. That's the polar wind in the data. And then this is sort of a schematic of it. So you gather the data, and in a satellite mission, the satellite might operate for 5 or 10 years. And the instruments have computers in them. So you can tell them, look at this. And you can tell them, look at some of this. And then change the way you do this and look at this. And so you can iterate as you gather data in a satellite. For Columbus, he's there. He finds all he can find, and he brings it back. It's harder for him to iterate because he has to do another voyage, basically, to do that. Okay, so now let's come across the bottom. You analyze the data and understand, in his case, that he'd found some islands. He thought he was off the coast of China and Japan. He thought that until he died, that all the places that he explored were near China and Japan. And so his explorations, his subsequent explorations, had to do with trying to get through these islands and get to the mainland. He was trying to get to the mainland. He was sure he would find that. For us, there were lots and lots of new things found. The most important thing we found with Dynamics Explorer, and this is typical of exploration, the most important thing we found was not something that we'd proposed to do and not something that we'd even thought about. It was the very large amount of gas that's flowing away from the Earth out into its space environment. We'd never thought about that. We, in fact, didn't even want to measure in that part of the orbit because we weren't interested. But other people were interested in that particular portion of the orbit, so we turned our instrument on anyway. And that was the most significant thing we found. It's very normal to find, when you're exploring, to find things you hadn't even thought about that you weren't even looking for that end up being more valuable than the things you were looking for. So in the case of Columbus, you know, he did not find the trade route to Japan and China. He just found North and South America, you know. And he found some gold, but he also found foodstuffs, corn, potatoes, that ended up feeding Europe for centuries. So they weren't things he was looking for, but it's typical that this happens. So you analyze the data, and you look at what the instrument is telling you, or you look at what you found from the ships, and you propose new knowledge. So now he's proposing to Europeans that there's a way to get to this place that has these things that I've found. His son ended up writing, you know, a chronicle of his voyages. New knowledge, ideas. The first thing you have when you look at new information, you have an idea about what it might mean. If you understand it a little bit better, you can maybe create a mathematical model of what it means. And if you really understand it, you can develop a theory. Now, this is a word that's very confusing to Americans. It's just a theory to us means we don't really understand it yet, but we've got some ideas. To a scientist, a theory is the answer. And you don't get to a theory until you've had ideas, they've been bounced off your colleagues, everybody's jumped all over them, made sure you've done it right, you develop models, and ultimately you get to a theory. And so it's confusing now in the lingo, you know, is there a theory about global warming or not? Well, some people have some theories, but does that mean that they really understand it, or does that mean that they've just got some ideas? There's a complication in our linguistics right now with respect to scientists. But for a scientist, if you've got a theory, you understand it as well as it can be understood. You propose the new knowledge, all of your peers look at it. If to get things published in America or any place in science, they're sent to a journal, the journal editor sends it to two or three people in the world who do the same kind of work that you do. And they say, is this paper right? And is this something new? And if it's not something new and correct, it won't get published. That's in contrast to journalism in the newspapers where the journalist has one day to write an article, usually. And so there isn't any peer review except for the editor. The editor looks at it and says, it looks pretty good, let's go with it. But that's a one-day thing. And so publishing in Science and Exploration is a very different, long, protracted. It can take a year or two to get something published, particularly if it's brand new. That makes it harder because that's a bigger leap of understanding for the people who are reviewing it. So then you publish in a scientific journal, and if you're good at what you do, and people like Joey Barnett are good at this, you tell the public what you're doing. You don't just write it in the journal and have the science community understand it. You talk about it to the public, because it's all of you that are paying for this, and you deserve to know what's going on if you want to know. And that means that the scientist needs to learn how to talk about it in ways that you can understand it, because not all of you are space scientists, or not all of you are geneticists or molecular biologists or whatever. So there's an obligation, I think, all scientists have an obligation to report to the public what they're getting for their money. And to do that requires the ability of the scientist to do it, but it also requires an information system, a media system that's willing to pass that information on. So there's the loop. Now what happens when you go through this loop is that you're smarter, you understand it better, so you think of the next experiment you need to do. You understand it better now. Columbus went the first time, and then he said, you know, I think if I'd gone a little bit more west, I probably would have gotten to China. So here's his second voyage, which took place just about a year after he got back from his first one, again in August and September, across the low-latitude, hurricane-filled Atlantic, and he didn't get a hurricane any time. But here's his second one. He came into Guadalupe. He named that for a church in Spain, and then he comes around through the British Virgin Islands, around Puerto Rico, and back to Hispaniola, to Isabella, where he left all his 40 people, all of whom were dead, because they had decided, I'm not quite sure what they thought, but they continued to sort of ravage the natives, both for gold, looking for gold, and certain social favors from the women. And the natives accepted that for a certain period of time, and then they said, you know, the chiefs sort of said, well, wait a minute, there's 40 of these guys, and there's X thousand of us, and that's enough of this. And so they eliminated the community of Isabella. And when Columbus got back then, he sort of had to reestablish there. But on his second voyage, he also went west again. He ceased trying to find China. So he goes over southern coast of Cuba, out to Jamaica, all the way down the southern coast of Cuba, and then all the way back to Jamaica again, back across the southern part of Hispaniola, and back home again. Didn't find China, but he found some things in here, a civilization that looked like it could be Chinese, the way they were dressed, and of course it wasn't, but that was of encouragement to him. So he went around that whole loop again. Then he went around it again. So here's his third voyage. He came farther south. They had a theory that the closer you got to the equator, the more likely you were to find gold. Oh, that's not right, but that was the theory of the time. So he came farther south. He came in right here by Trinidad and Venezuela. He went through here, went to the island of Margarita, and then this just shows you what a good sailor he was. He knew, I mean, his instruments were very crude, his navigation was, but he knew sort of where Hispaniola was. So he sailed all the way across the middle of the Caribbean and hit it. I mean, just guessing. And longitude is very difficult to determine if you've read the book Longitude. I mean, you got to have a good watch to do longitude, and they didn't have that. He was not welcomed in Santo Domingo, even though he'd established that. He wasn't a good governor. He was a wonderful sailor. He was not a good governor. And so they put him in, actually put him in jail, because they weren't happy with his leadership. And then they shipped him back to, he went back in chains back to Spain on the Green Line here. And he came one more time, still trying to find China and Japan. He came across, they gave him old ships that had worms eating them, and they were leaking badly. Came across, avoided Santo Domingo, and kept going west until he got down here into Central America. Then he had to try to sail against the wind. Remember, the wind down here blows east to west, and these ships don't sail into the wind well. They're big square rig ships. They sail downwind wonderfully, but anyway, he had to go into the wind here, and then all the way down the coast, the wind's blowing him up against the coast. Then he had to go. This was a very difficult leg of the trip, and the ships are sinking. One of them sank down here near Panama. And then finally he said, okay, I think I know where Jamaica is, and we better get there. So he went all the way across the Caribbean and hit Jamaica, which is unbelievable. And the rest of the ship sank, and he was on Jamaica for a year. They sent somebody in one of the longboats back to Hispaniola to tell him that Columbus was shipwrecked there, and the government, the leadership there, wasn't happy with him, and so they waited almost a year to come get him. But they did. They came and got him, and he lived on with his crew here, and then his last trip back, and then he died a couple of years later. So this shows kind of, this is going around the loop again. Voyage, for him, voyage one, he learned something, voyage two, he learned something, voyage three. He did it four times around this loop. I've been around this loop a couple of big times. The first one I just showed you was with the Dynamics Explorer instrument. And then we said, but if we could build an instrument that was bigger, that would let more gas in, then it would be more sensitive and we could learn more about the space environment. And so there's that instrument. Now this instrument is about the size of a microwave. The other one was more like a shoebox, small shoebox. This is more like one or two microwaves. And these are the entrance apertures, and there are a lot of them. So this instrument works in a roughly similar way to the previous one, but it's much larger and much more sensitive, so we could learn more about the space environment. And to do this one, and I'll show it to you on the spacecraft. Here's the spacecraft. Here's Stan Fields again, still doing wonderful work. There's the instrument right there. It's hanging on the side of the spacecraft. This spacecraft, you can see, it's about 10 feet across. This was called the Polar spacecraft. It was a mission of NASA's. And so we went around that loop again with this instrument. Now, just so you'll know about timing, I wrote the proposal for this instrument in 1978. Now, think about this in terms of careers. I wrote the proposal in 1978 and was launched in 1994. And it acquired data until 2008. So that's 30 years. And you don't have many 30-year, you can't do 30 years many times in your career. It just takes a long time to do this. Yeah?
In what year did you launch the first?
It was launched in 1980. So this instrument was proposed before that one actually got into space, but we were learning stuff all along, and we realized, hey, we can make that next one better. And so, but it still, it was 14 years after the first one that the second one was launched. Okay, so to end up there then, let me see where we are. Yeah, to end up there, for Columbus, it was to understand this part of the world. He thought he was where he wanted to be, at the other side of the Pacific. But his voyages defined the Caribbean area of this part of the world, and then Amerigo Vespucci came over, and he was a lot better talking to the public about what he found than Columbus was. So that's why we're called America instead of Columbia. And so this telling the story of what you're doing has a lot of important ramifications. But that was Columbus. The result of Columbus exploration was to understand this area. Now, this is a little bit complicated, but here's the Earth, and here's that magnetosphere again I was talking about. And the result of these series of explorations that I've been lucky enough to be involved in has measured this region pretty thoroughly, and now we understand that at least half, if not more, of the particles that fill up the Earth's magnetosphere come from the Earth. They don't come from the Sun. Even though the solar wind blows past the Earth constantly and it has a lot of gas in it that could get into the magnetosphere, it seems that most of the gas comes from the Earth itself. The energy comes from the Sun, both the light energy, which ionizes the top of our atmosphere and gives this plasma, it's called ionized gas, that flows up the magnetic field lines. The light energy from the Sun does that, and then this energy that comes from the solar wind flowing past, it's like a windsock. It's like a wind blowing on this magnetic envelope, and it blows it out into stretches it out into a long tail. This just goes out a million miles back here. And so, but the energy that comes from this wind blowing by helps bring particles up out of the Earth's atmosphere and fill this region up. So we actually found a new region called the warm plasma cloak, which had never been understood before. And it came from looking at data from, in fact, a half a dozen different satellites, but particularly the two that I've shown you. And looking at that and looking at that and putting the pieces of the puzzle on the dining room table until you can see what the picture is. And so, you know, science and exploration progress that way. Everything you do is another piece of the universal puzzle. And the more pieces you have, the more clear the picture is, and the more you're able to understand about the environment you live in, or in the case of Joey's work, the more you're able to understand what you need to do to take care of an important human health problem. Paul, did you have?
Is the Earth losing mass then?
It is. Yeah, so there's a constant stream of stuff out. Some of it gets trapped in here and just circulates around, but some of it goes out all the way out the tail and is lost. So that's a good point. So we're losing mass, and it's tons of hydrogen and helium that are leaving the Earth, but there's a whole lot of tons of it around. So it's not a mass loss that is something we have to worry about. It's small. It's large in one sense, but it's small in terms of all that's there.
Yeah, wouldn't the solar winds carry away these greenhouse gases that we're so concerned with today?
Well, they don't, because the solar wind, the magnetic field of the Earth, which is shown by this outer shape here, is sort of a bubble that the Earth is in the middle of. And so the greenhouse gases are right down here in the top of the atmosphere, you know, within 100 miles of the Earth. Remember, this is 60,000 miles. And so the solar wind, when it gets to the Earth, it has to flow around it, because the magnetic field is like a blunt object to it. And so it comes up to it, and this is not a good, you know, that first picture I had, I think, is better. Let me do that. Yeah, so down here, see, it flows out, and then as it approaches this object, it can tell there's an object up there. There's a shock front out here, and then it flows around it. So it doesn't get far enough in to contact the top of the atmosphere and erode greenhouse gases away. Now, the Earth's magnetic field changes, and every once in a while it flips. I mean, every once in a while, like in tens of millions of years, but it flips. And when it flips, there's a time period when it's very low in value. And in that time period, then the solar wind could get in and probably strip away a lot of the atmosphere. And then the atmosphere comes back because, you know, many of the gases come up out of the Earth, and they're gravitationally held to the Earth, and the atmosphere would rebuild itself. But that's a very good thought. Okay, I've got one other little thing that I want to show you, and then I'm happy to answer questions. And in the spirit of show and tell, I have some show and tell up here. I don't have human hearts like Joey did. Like I said, I mean, he's a hard act to follow. But anyway, I have a model of the Santa Maria that's partially finished. I have a couple of coins that are Columbus coins. I have the aperture for the instrument that I showed you. And I'll be happy to show you those things. So let me see if I can run one more of these videos.
What's the life expectancy of these
satellites? They usually are designed for 3 or 4 years, and they usually last 10 or more. So, and the Hubble was launched in, did anybody see that last night on Nova? The unbelievable, the fixing of the last mission to fix Hubble. So it was launched in 1990, so it's 18 years in. Typically, the engineers do a much more successful job in building things than they're willing to guarantee, for obvious reasons. And so you establish a lifetime that you want for the satellite, and you design toward that with margins, but usually they're around for a lot longer, which is good. You get more, you amortize your investment. Okay, so let me see if I can do one more of these. So we did, going back to what I mentioned a while ago, we tried when I was at NASA to show exploration to the public. And so I created an event at the Marshall Space Flight Center. It was called the Von Braun Exploration Forum. And this first video I showed you was one that we showed in that. And what we did in that was we would bring together people who are explorers with people who you would know, entertainers, a lot of them were entertainers, who were interested in exploration. And we'd have this event at the Civic Center in Huntsville. Usually there were a couple of thousand people there. And we did that for 10 years in a row. The idea was to attract the public based on people that they wanted to see and use that opportunity to teach them about exploration, to let them feel the spirit of exploration and what it does for America. So we did that for 10 years. When I retired from NASA 13 years ago, at my retirement, they took some video of me in different places and some of the video from the Von Braun Forum and put it all together into a little thing that sort of said, you know, here's what Rick Chappell is about. And so this has some Columbus stuff in it that I'm, so, and it kind of ties Columbus and me together a little bit. So let me show you this, if we're lucky. It'll work. You can tell what I'm interested in. Okay, let me see. Come on, baby, crank up. Here we go. Okay. So you'll see some people you know in here. Hopefully. We need the sound. We still have no sound. Let's see. I wonder if Rocky turned that off after. You can see the images, you just don't know what they're saying. Bob, do you think he's out there anywhere? I don't know. Oh, it's coming. I hadn't touched anything. Did Bob, did you find something back there? Okay, so let's try this start over again thing, which is fraught with difficulty, but. Okay. Okay. I'm probably gonna get into the same thing I was in a while ago. So we're probably gonna have to do a restart. Let's see.
Budget.
For the instrument? The first instrument was about $1 million. The second instrument was about $5 million. Okay, so let me see. Here we go.
Restart.
I hit resume. And y'all was saying, what's this guy in the space business about. He can't even run it, play a DVD. All right. Okay. Okay. So I gave you a foreshadowing a while ago about the crow's nest. That's probably Apollo 11 or 12, so 69.
In May of 1961, I was a high school student of 17 when John Kennedy committed our nation to land men on the moon. I felt then that he was speaking directly to me, and I changed my career at that time and changed my life. Drawn by the thrill of space exploration, I determined to direct my studies toward science and technology, with the hope of someday possibly making a contribution to humankind's move outward into the solar system.
Like the spirit that binds us together, we are so much more.
These are all excerpts from that, from those Von Braun forums that we have.
Space exploration, the kinds of things that we've talked about tonight in terms of life and the universe, it's about searching, and it's about reaching out, going beyond the everyday, doing things that nobody's ever done before. And when you're involved in that sort of work, it's thrilling. Exploration brings with it a covenant and a sort of brotherhood among those people who carry it out. And it tends to be a brotherhood of people who call the flame of the sun that brings us life, and the flame of knowledge that gives us the vision, and the flame of the rocket that takes us to space.
Okay.